So let me now introduce you to our very special guest presenter, Kevin Harrington. Kevin Harrington is an instructor in the Department of Health Administration at St. Joseph's College of Maine, as well as in the Department of Health Information Management at Temple University. He currently teaches healthcare finance, healthcare delivery, and healthcare reimbursement at both the graduate and undergraduate levels. He has also taught courses in healthcare ethics, healthcare documentation, as well as legal aspects of health administration. Mr. Harrington has more than 30 years of experience in healthcare in areas such as health information management, managing home care companies on a local and regional level, and consulting in the post-acute sector. He's a leading authority on healthcare reimbursement and revenue cycle management, or RCM, and he has extensive experience in implementing the RCM model in physicians' offices and other healthcare organizations outside of the acute care setting. He is also the president of Professional Revenue Management Services, a consulting firm focused on healthcare reimbursement, specifically revenue cycle management services in the physician's office and other healthcare settings. He holds a master's degree in healthcare administration and is a registered health information administrator. And he's also certified in healthcare privacy from the American Health Information Management Association. So with that, I'm going to now turn things over to Kevin to present. Kevin, I've just passed you the presenter privileges.
All right, thank you, Sophie. Good afternoon, everybody. First, I want to thank everybody for attending. I want to move the slide and get my, yeah, I never like pictures, but, you know, the goal of the book, I couldn't write this in the first slide. The, you know, we get into, you know, different things in our lives based on our career path, what we're looking for, what interests us. I kind of took a different path. I woke up to a physician in my left ear telling me, I don't think you're going to live through the weekend. And then when I looked to my right, there was a priest giving me my last rites. So I couldn't talk because I was on a ventilator. And I thought, well, if I can walk out of here, I want to try and give back. It wasn't a great experience being a patient. I want to be able to give back and educate people on, you know, health care and not to feel like a number. So I did walk out, and, you know, I got into the healthcare business in home care and specialty pharmacy and, you know, different parts of the post-acute network. And there was one man who gave me an opportunity to learn. And, you know, through his kindness and allowing me to learn different parts of the business that I would not have gotten in any managerial training program or any type of internship, I just felt compelled that I got to give back. So the only way I could give back was, you know, looking at the book eventually, but I started just giving back to patients. And then I said, all right, I feel like I achieved something, but what else can I do? And that's when I decided to write, you know, to write the book, because, you know, I read different materials. I teach healthcare finance, and I was just glancing through a book one day, and, you know, it was just giving me the feeling that, hey, we've done it this way for so long, why change? Well, here we are in healthcare. That's an ever-changing market that we just went through I-10 with all the fear of that. And then we're also changing our reimbursement model from a retrospective payment type on the insurance companies to a risk-sharing prospective model that can leave some of us, you know, scratching our heads saying, what do I need to learn? How can I manage this? What's my responsibility? Yeah, as an administrator, we're totally responsible for the profit and loss of the facility. So that's why I put the book together, and I really appreciate everybody just taking an interest in it. And for those of you who adopt it, you know, I say thank you now, and I'll say thank you again if there's ever a time I could be of help. So the reason, you know, the goal of the book is we want to make the healthcare administrators, and it's not just limited to an administrator in the facility. It could be registered health information administrators, could be, you know, nursing staff, nursing supervisors, nursing management. Anybody that's in a managerial role with a budget, you know, can really benefit from this book. We go into areas of healthcare finance and reimbursement, you know, because it's always changing. We talk about contracting with an insurance company. You know, why is that important? you know, there's often times where facilities are offered, oh, we'll give you a better rate, you know, if you do this, but what's the volume? What is it, what's the impact? What is it gonna cost me? You know, they promise this, but do we get that? You know, can we promise this and get that? We look at compliance issues that surround the healthcare administrator, and we look at the impact on reimbursement at all levels at the resource consumption. You know, there's one thing to say, well, you know, it seems like revenues are down, but our expenses are up. You know, how do we figure out what, you know, what's really going on? So we give the administrator some tools like case mix index, which will help us to match up, you know, what's the severity level of the patient we're treating versus what's our resource consumption, you know, for the patient base that we currently have in our facility or we've had come through our facility. And we really want to give the manager just an edge over, you know, their competition. We want to be able to, or I want to be able to, in writing the book, but we want to be able to as instructors to give the student the ability to see the landscape, walk into a facility, know where to go as far as maybe not logistically where this room is, but know where to go in regards to what department and what impact point we have in the facility. We talk about some key topics in financial management, which sometimes it could be the first time they hear of it, or it could be, you know, they're really well-versed, but it's good to hear it again. We walk the student through various parts of the accounting authorities, whether it be CMS, GAAP, or what have you. And we show them about, you know, what the importance of timely information. How come we do a month-end close? Why does it have to be done today? What's the importance of a DINFIB, or discharge but not final billed? If it's over 3 days, what should we be looking at? What's the impact on the facility? And how we use financial information. Do we use it in a way that we can manage our facility better? Do we use it in a way that we can manage our care and outcomes and our facility, all one, tying it all together? And look at verifiability and understandability. You know, what can we verify all the information we have on our financials, and can we make sense of it? And we make sense of it through reports. So we walk the student through the different types of reports, from balance sheets to income statements to cash flow statements, and the difference between those two, or three, or all of them, matter of fact. You know, a balance sheet is just a snapshot. You know, an income statement is over a period of time, whether it be a month or a quarter, 6 months or a year. And you just take them through the basic elements of accounting, because they need this to do their budgets. They need to be able to look at a general ledger and understand that there was a mistake or something needs to be different. For instance, I had an occurrence where we had a shrink in our inventory and it was going to cost my location $1 million. And I said, I don't feel like that's correct. I did my research. I found out that the general ledger entry was made in error, and we backtracked and found it. And subsequently, you know, everything was fixed. My location didn't have to take $1 million shrink. And then we will take the student through the sources of financial data in healthcare organizations. Like, where do we get our data from? What does it mean? How does the reporting come through? Who's responsible for it? Some of the other key topics that we talk about are reimbursement. Now, I have a question for you. It may seem simple, but it's just something to spark some interest. And you can answer the question. I think Sophie will give us a little bit of instruction. After I ask you the question, Sophie can tell you how to go about answering the question. And just get some feedback and some thought process, because this is new. It's not new, but it's a newer thing for some people, capitation. And my question for everybody is an occupied bed, a patient in the bed, more profitable than an unoccupied bed in a capitated environment in a hospital?
And to answer the question, simply click the feedback icon, which is on the right-hand side of your screen. It looks like a little check mark over a talking bubble. If you click on that, you'll get a yes or no option. Click one of those. And I can give the results live. And it looks like, well, we only have one respondent at this point. Oh, we've got three saying no and one saying yes at this point. Now we have six no's and one yes. Seven no's and two yeses. So it looks like overwhelmingly people are going for no, Kevin.
There you go. Well, that's correct. When we look at an occupied bed in a facility under a capitated environment, sometimes we lose the focus of what we're really in the capitation for. If we look prospectively, we want to make sure that the patients are well, preventive medicine, taking care of things up front. When they come into the facility and utilize the resources, then it's not as profitable as if the patient was healthy and not in the bed. That I use to spark interest with the students to talk to them about how do we look at reimbursement? What's the differences of it? Do we understand it? What's the impact? You know, especially in today's environment, we have, you know, the low premium, high deductible plans that are now shifting risk. So we talk to the student and teach them the differences between prospective and retrospective. Retrospective in the past where the insurance company knew we had surgeries over the weekend, we just don't know what we're going to be charged. To the prospective environment, we know we had surgeries over the weekend and we know what we're going to be charged from the providers. The differences in the claim forms, whether it be the CMS 1500, which is your red and white form, or the UB04, which is your more detailed form for institutions, and the electronic versions of the same. And we talk about consents. Consents are really important. The use of an advanced beneficiary notice is something that can be, you know, somewhat, you have to use it cautiously. We can only use an ABN when we feel that we're not going to be paid for this procedure, and the reasons are we can't use the ABN as a blanket consent form that if we don't get paid, we can bill the patient. So we go through all the various, you know, reasons why we can and can't use it, when we can use it, when we can't use it. And then we look at the legal issues surrounding claims processing. It's really important for the administrator to understand how claims get processed, how we drop our bills, when do we look for payment, are they electronic, are they on paper, and so forth. And we want to be able to give them, you know, all the data that's coming through, the mass quantities of data, how it relates to reimbursement, and then how the relationship between reimbursement and the financial data. It has to be accurate. It has to be clean. We have to have a very good charge description master. That's where 70% of our coding is done automatically. I've had facilities talk to me about, you know, our CDM, our charge description master, is off. It's just not right. And what it's doing, it's either underbilling or overbilling. So either you have a problem with your stakeholders, you have a problem with, you know, the insurance companies or the government because you're overbilling. So it's important that we know what our data is, how it's working, where we can find it, how we can manage it. There we go. You know, then it's important that we talk to the students and walk them through the different parts of each different payer type, Medicare, Medicaid. If you've seen one Medicaid program, you've seen one Medicaid program. Each state has requirements that they have to have as a core element or parts of a Medicaid program, but then there's state can make a decision to do different things outside of that as well. Commercial insurance, managed care. We talked about TRICARE because that's a, you know, they're a big payer. And we take them into the different settings, whether it be an inpatient, outpatient, skilled nursing facility, you know, home health and hospice, physician's offices and alike. So it's important that we take the student and give them a real good education on these payers because one way or another, at some point in time, whether they're going to be an administrator or know somebody that's in the system, to be able to help them to navigate through the different types of payers and what the requirements are. We also talk about, you know, for the administrator, the prospective payment system in an inpatient and outpatient setting. Home health has a prospective payment model. Inpatient psych facilities, inpatient rehab facilities, and transplant. I mean, I had to learn the hard way about transplants. My brother ended up, you know, needing a pancreas. So, oddly enough, I was writing the book at the same time. So, I did all my research, and I said, gosh, I didn't know this. And it's just good to see that we have the information here. And then it helps the student find out where to go to find more information, whether it be a you know, different organ donation programs or CMS or so forth, but we try and give them everything inside the book. And, you know, it should be helpful for them to see things that aren't commonly asked. Renal dialysis centers, you know, they're more prevalent now than in the past, and we need to know how that reimbursement works. We also talk to the administrators and the students, and no matter I say administrator, I apologize, it could be nursing, could be administration, could be any level of management. We go through the ICD-9 and then the I-10 transition. We talk about it in an inpatient and outpatient and physician's office setting. I go into physician's offices all the time. They think they're the best coders in the world, and we look at the reports, and we help guide them, and this will help the administrator or the student to understand what the different parts of the E&M coding model is. You know, how do we look at a visit? What's important? What's a DRG? You know, why does it make sense right now? What do I have to look at? What does it mean to me as an administrator? And then to tie everything together in the revenue cycle, it's very important that no matter what administrator, what department it is, we have to align everything together as one full circle. We're going to give the instructor all the necessary tools to instruct the student in this area. You know, talking about high cost outliers, I have examples in the book and in Navigate too. We talk about transfer cases, you know, how important they are. Why are they important to the payer? Why is it fair? You know, how are they calculated? You know, what was done in the past and what's going to be done in the future and how to look for them. High cost outliers, if we don't pick up everything in the coding and the documentation, we might, you know, not be billing for everything that we should be billing for in a facility. And then we go into fraud and abuse. We take the student through different areas where they can learn about, you know, what is CMS looking for? What is the OIG looking for? What's the OIG work plan for this year? And in general, we can look at the OIG work plan and kind of guide our next year of what we're doing. On top of being compliant in every area that we can possibly be, let's see what the OIG is looking at. How can we prevent fraud and abuse? My dad always told me to plan your work, work your plan. And then when you've done that, plan your work again and work your plan. It's a cycle. And we want to teach the student that we should audit, we should give feedback, we should reevaluate, audit, educate, feedback. It's just a constant circle because we're not static. We're not a static environment. And if we can get them to think outside the box and understand that it's a constant item that you need to look at, it'll be very helpful for them. Different scenarios that the administrator can get involved in, they might have a huge referral source and they say, well, we want to do X, Y, and Z. Well, hopefully we'll give them enough information where they don't know that maybe I need to look into it a little bit further. How can I interpret the different or current situation that I'm in and relate that to the current regulations for, you know, any kickback laws? You know, how can I look at this as far as, you know, am I a federally funded agency? Am I not? You know, what am I held accountable to? And then teach them about the physician self-referral rules and then how to make a compliance program, because the compliance program is very important. So we can give them all the tools to do that. And then we'll talk about incentive programs, meaningful use, electronic health records, pay for performance. There's quite a few healthcare providers that are looking at increasing their risk for a larger reward. So we teach them, you know, how does pay for performance work? How does P for P? How does that work? How does physician incentive programs work? How does quality outcomes work? You know, how can we work in a patient-centered medical home? What does it mean? What do we have to do? What's some of the infrastructure? And then talk about some of the various demonstration projects that are coming up or have already been up through CMS, so they're aware of them and see what they have to do for their future to be able to better manage their facilities. The other piece is the recovery audit contractor. The book goes through in detail, you know, the goals of the RAC program. You know, what do we need to do? How can we handle it? How do we respond to a request for records? How do we respond, you know, to the RAC? How do we use them as an education source? You know, can we get information from them? Can we have them teach us? Can we teach them how to respond to a RAC request, not just in response to writing a check, but reading what they're saying is not coded correctly, reading what they're saying is not reimbursed properly, and going back and saying, yes, I agree, and make sure it's 100%. And we teach the students how to say, no, I disagree, and this is why. So how important it is to respond and to pay back anything that's overpaid is just as important to go back in and say, hey, no, this was paid correctly, or wait a minute, this was underpaid. So the RAC is, you know, just like revenue cycle management, it's a cycle, it's a process that is not one-dimensional in one direction. It is something that you have to look at and take it into your facility and integrate everything that you see that comes back from the RAC and make sure you learn from it. If you made a mistake, you make the refund back to the facility, back to the RAC. But then you teach your facility, this is what we did, this is what impacted us, this is why. We want to find out why we did something. And then in the same breath, why did we do it right? And you go back and reinforce it. It's one thing to correct somebody, but you know, we can teach the students through the use of the book is, hey, we can also thank them for doing the right job, and we can teach them how to continue to look forward. It's not just a prospective payment model, it's a prospective vision that we have to manage our healthcare environment you know, with a professional and open door policy. We have to be there for them and be able to show them how to look forward. I pulled out, I think there's 7 or 8 case studies that will, you know, really challenge a student in different areas of financial management, you know, telemarketing and compliance. You know, that's an area that can seem so innocent, but if we did it wrong, we can really cost the facility a lot of money and a lot of embarrassment. There's a transfer case case study, and there's a recovery audit contractor case study. So you can see, I think it's 8 case studies we have. And then, you know, the case studies will challenge a student. I say this a lot, is stretch it out, you know, make them think outside the box. How do we look at financial management? There's not just one answer for anything. There's probably multiple. We go through claims processing, what's compliance. You know, we make them really think about it and try and give them the experience prior to walking in the facility so they haven't seen it for the first time. You know, we give them the ability to be experienced as much as they can, you know, through their studies to walk in and be able to navigate, you know, this environment. And then the case study, you know, it'll give the instructors also the ability to evaluate the students' answers, look for areas of improvement. You know, we can give them the ability to think outside the box and tell them, you're doing a great job, this is what you see. And then most importantly, you'll be able to respond and, you know, give support and guidance, you know, through this learning process, because this is a time we want them to experience the learning process of, hey, I can make a mistake, but I can talk to the instructor and I can get the right guidance. You know, making a mistake in the healthcare environment, you know, I've made enough of them, I own up to it, and we try and do better moving forward. But if we can give them the opportunity to avoid a few of them, it'll help them, you know, really look at a smoother transition into the healthcare arena and more successful, because in the middle of all this is a patient, you know, and that's sometimes, you know, that can be lost, that, you know, we're dealing with reimbursement, we're dealing with administration, we're dealing with, you know, quality and numbers, but there's a patient that drives all this. So it helps us keep centered, because really, and I'll finish up, I think this is my last one. We talk about a healthcare administrator knowing where to ask questions. It's not always having the answer, but giving them the ability to ask a question, you know, because not asking the right question or asking the right question to the wrong group, you know, the person can lose respect for other departments that are trying, he or she may be trying to integrate themselves into a, you know, an operation that they have to, you know, win over each department. And by not knowing where to go and how to ask the question could, you know, hinder that type of growth. And especially in a prospective payment environment, the responsibility of profit and loss is solely on the facility and the administrator. And the book will help drive this thought process, you know, for the healthcare administrator, whatever. Again, if it's nursing, administration, if it's outpatient, surgical centers, and so forth, it will give them the edge, you know, that they can take into the field. And I've had nurses and other administrators come in and say, now I can basically, I can tie it together. I can see what I did for Mrs. Smith, and now I can see what it did for her, and I can see what it did for the facility. And it's a very rewarding scenario if we can take patient care, turn it into quality outcomes, and then turn it into a good revenue cycle and a profitability for the facility that we're in, because then we're able to turn the lights on. We're able to take care of more patients. We're able to expand our services, maybe even our footprint in the community. Maybe we're even able to give back to the community, you know, more so because we have the ability to do it, because we're financially strong, because we're getting paid for what we're doing. I don't think we should be paid for something we don't do, but if we're paid correctly for what we do, then I think it's a win-win for everybody. So, you know, that's why, you know, I wrote the book. I brought my experiences into it, good and bad. And I think the end result is we have a tool that we can use for healthcare administrators to have them come into the field and immediately make a difference in somebody's life. So.
Great. Thank you very much, Kevin. That was a great presentation. I'm going to go ahead and take presenter privileges back, and at this point we're going to move into the question and answer session, and so, you know, we welcome your questions, whether it's about the presentation or the book itself or the materials that come with it. And just to, as a reminder, you have two options for asking questions. You can either use, if you want to type your question and I'll read it, you can use either the chat box feature or the Q&A box, which are on the right-hand side of your screen. If you're not seeing those boxes, if you simply mouse over the top of your screen, you'll get options for chat, Q&A, and you can click either one of those. If you would like to voice your question out loud, which we encourage you to do, we have an operator on the line who will manage that process. You'll simply need to press star 1 on your telephone keypad, and she will cue you up and unmute your line one at a time. Marianne, did I give those instructions correctly?
Yes, you did, and when you do press star 1, you will hear a tone acknowledging your request and a prompt to record your name.
Great, thank you. And
you're
I do have some questions coming through on the chat box, which I will go ahead and read. The first question we have, Kevin, this is for you. Does the change to high deductible health insurance plans have that much of an impact on a healthcare facility since they are still being paid by the health insurance company?
Yeah, there's a large impact, potentially. It depends on the amount of the deductible for the patient. However, it's just they're shifting the risk from the insurance company in the past paying 100% or 80-20 to now they're adding a $5,000, $6,000 deductible, then paying 80-20. So now the facility is, you know, part of the risk. Now the patient's a larger part of the risk, and we have to now change our collection models. We have to educate our patients up front. We have to talk about different financing options, whether it be care credit or healthcare finance solutions, where they can come in and immediately look at the patient's financial history and give them, you know, a loan to pay their, you know, $5,000 deductible because they come in and have to have surgery. So it is changing, and it makes, you know, it does pose, you know, some roadblocks for the administrator to look at cash. You know, we see it where now we have an AR for the insurance company, but now on top of that, we have a larger AR in our patient balances. So it does promote, you know, a different style of collection management and, you know, upfront revenue cycle management for the facility and the patient.
Great, thank you. Kevin, I have another question here for you about the case studies. Could you summarize the types of case studies that you're including in the text? What specific types and what are the activities?
In the case studies, I'll pull them up. I went through and I wanted to make the case studies more real-time, you know, real-life scenarios for the administrator. I mean, we have our crazy ones that come up every now and then, but I wanted to keep it to be more, you know, more technical, more, you know, geared towards the administrator. And I'm just pulling them up right now just to see them. You know, for instance, the telemarketing is a nice case study. You know, it makes the student go in and look at what are the requirements for, I'm just moving my slide here, you know, what are the requirements for the Social Security Act with regards to telemarketing calls? You know, what is the importance of data? You know, how simple is it to have data, you know, migrate from your possession into somebody else's where it shouldn't have happened? And then we ask the student to plan, and you know, what plan can be put in place, you know, to avoid these federal guidelines, you know, to stay out of noncompliance. And then, you know, in the typical case that we give them, we ask them, you know, would the plan in place be in violation of any federal guidelines? And then they have to elaborate on that and research the plan and then come back with, you know, their feedback on the case. And it makes them look at, you know, there's not just one spot for an answer. We have the OIG, we have state regs, we have CMS, we have all these different places we need to look into and find out, you know, what regs are we looking at, what regs are we going to potentially violate, and then what do we need to do to be compliant? So it makes a student say, all right, I found the issues, how do I fix them? And it gives them the ability to go through and really create, you know, a solution that'll be good for the facility. And then we ask them to understand what the penalties are. So we give the student a lot of work to do and to understand what the penalties can be, you know, for a violation of that. And we go through claims processing. We talk about, you know, some CMS issues when it comes to claims processing. You know, of the cases that were reviewed by CMS, 14 of the claims were reviewed. Medicare paid it correctly and 6 were paid incorrectly. You know, how does the student handle it? And they have to calculate what the recovery should be, you know, back to the insurance company. You know, how can we improve this process once we found out what the problem was? You know, and it's not just a simple answer. We have to see what do we have to do to be compliant with the insurance company, but now what do we have to do internally to make these measures work correctly inside, you know, our current environment? And then the other ones, you know, follow the same suit. We have a managed care, we have transfer cases. There's some home health. There's one home health case study. National Correct Coding Initiatives is case 10. You know, a RAC case as well. You know, what are we looking at? How the RAC collects the data? You know, how would we recommend the CMS to comply to the findings of the study? So it's not just now we have the answer. We know what it is, but how do we apply it? How do we take action? How do we ensure that the RAC, you know, refers all appropriate cases of potential fraud, how they move them back to CMS and so forth. So we're making the student look back. Sometimes they're given the answer and they have to, you know, really develop a corrective action plan to work through it. So we're getting them to look, you know, I can say forward, backwards, sideways. We're trying to make them look as if they were in an environment working from 9 to 5 or, well, an administrator works from 8 to 8. How to do this, how to look at it in a comprehensive way to get the right answers and protect the facility and the facility's reputation at the same time. So hopefully that answered your question.
Great, thank you, Kevin. We've actually got quite a few questions coming through in the chat box. One question that I think I can answer, which is a great question about how to access the case studies, and those are actually found within the Navigate to Advantage access that comes free with the book. So, and I'm going to talk about that a little bit more on the next slide, but as you can see on this cover image, there's a little white icon at the bottom that indicates that it comes with an access code card, a Navigate to Advantage access code card. And again, that's free with the book. It allows your students to redeem the code online. They'll get access to the case studies, and depending how you want to use Navigate to, if you opt for the full course enrollment, you'll have a course ID and you can actually make it a full course and interact with your students through Navigate to. But that is where the case studies are found. That's a supplement to the book. Before I move on to the other questions in the chat box, I'll just pass it over to Mary Ann for a moment in case we have some questions on the line.
There are no questions on the phone lines.
Okay. All right, great. So from the chat box, we have a question. Are there insurance companies that are currently reimbursing providers based on quality indicators as opposed to quantity, or are they still in a pilot project mode?
It's my experience in working with some of the larger payers on the East Coast that they are paying for quality. You know, they are reimbursing facilities for quality outcomes, and they're looking at, you know, risk arrangements for, you know, if the facility will take more risk, they get more reward if they believe in their quality of the delivery of their health care. And there's also something that's coming up through CMS, which is your merit-based incentive payment system, or MIPS, and alternative payment models are also coming up, and things like that for quality. So yes, you know, quality outcomes, you know, are being viewed as something that, you know, can benefit the provider.
Great, thank you, Kevin. Another question from the chat box. I'm a healthcare administrator and college professor teaching healthcare courses. Do you feel your book is geared towards a healthcare finance course or a managed care course?
That's a great question. I view managed care as its own entity, so I would say I didn't write it in the managed care thought process. So I do cover managed care, what the different models, the staff model, group model, and so forth, and explaining what managed care, their goals are, and everything around it. But I did not write it for just that. I wrote it really for the, and we can say finance. I love reimbursement, but without reimbursement, we don't have finance, and without finance, I don't have reimbursement. So it was more geared towards the finance and reimbursement portion of, you know, of our healthcare model or delivery model, which really encompasses it and does take into account. We do address managed care, but not, it wasn't written just for managed care.
Okay, very good. You focus on home health care in considerable detail. Is there a reason this area versus other PAC facilities and their respective reimbursement models?
I only talked about health, home health as, you know, that's what came up and that's where I got started in. But in reality, the book is really written for more of a broad approach to the reimbursement models that are out there, not just home care. Home care is just one small piece of what we do. Reimbursement itself is structured in a way that, you know, it does dictate some redundancy that will take the administrator through various parts of it. But there's so many different parts of reimbursement, from the ambulatory surgical center, the ASC list, what can be done there versus somewhere else, what can be done in a physician's office versus an ASC versus a hospital outpatient or a certain, you know, operative suite. I apologize for giving that home care spin, but it's really the book itself is more of a broad approach to all the areas of reimbursement, whether it be inpatient all the way through inpatient psychiatric facilities to skilled nursing facilities to LTACs, whether it be a burn unit, ventilator dependent, into the renal dialysis and transplants. So the book itself is very well integrated to the whole healthcare market, and I apologize for talking more about home care, but I don't want to give that impression it's just a home care finance book.
And we do have a question from the phone lines.
Oh, great.
From the line of Lou Bodine.
Kevin, thank you very much for. Hi, Kevin. How you doing? Thank you very much for doing this webinar. It's very interesting. I've taught a healthcare finance course 7 or 8 times now, and typically I've had to create material that you now put into a book, because most of the books that I've been, most of the texts I've been using are for people who want to be hospital accountants or healthcare accountant type people, and most of the people that I instruct are not in that, you know, are not specific finance people. They're not accountants.
Mm-hmm.
And auditors. The question I have for you is, do you see this book geared more toward the undergraduate or the graduate level?
I think it can go either way. I wrote it in a way that it can fit both models. The instructor has a lot of freedom with this because I give them the core elements of every part of the reimbursement model, And it's like you said, it's not just a finance book. It's a reimbursement compliance. It's a forward-thinking book that gives, you know, you can take it to different levels. It fits either one. You know, as far as I can see, because I when I wrote it, I wanted to make sure it was versatile enough to be able to go both ways, you know, in the education part.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks for the question.
Sure.
Thank you, Lou, for that question. And I just noticed, I just want to repeat the instructions for answering, a voicing your question, is to press star one. I just noticed on an earlier slide I had pound one, but it's actually star one. Is that correct, Marianne?
That is correct.
Okay, so star one if you want to voice your question out loud. I do have another chat box question about accessing the case studies in Navigate 2. How do I access the case studies in Navigate 2? And it's actually very easy. The book, if you have a review copy of the book, if you just open it up, inside you'll have an access code card, and you just peel back and you get the access code number. You can redeem that on our website, jblearning.com. You likely, if you're already using a Jones and Bartlett book, or if you've requested a complimentary review copy in the past, then you likely already have an account with us, and you simply redeem that access code, and then right away you have access to all the materials within Navigate 2, which includes the full ebook, preloaded assessments, practice activities, and other things. And the case studies are located within that. So your students all get that for free. They get that right away. If you opt for the full course enrollment, that creates an interactive course where you can communicate with your students. You can assign them, you know, homework or assessments or to read the case studies or whatever. So that's all from the access code card. I do have another question here, Kevin. You mentioned on your incentive program slide that healthcare professionals needed to be more aware to take on more risk. What do you mean by risk? Is it patient or financial risk?
Financial. The plans are coming out with, you know, we can have our normal reimbursement. I get paid X amount of dollars for this procedure or office visit or any type of healthcare transaction. When we shift the risk a little bit, they say, well, if we pay you a little bit less and you can demonstrate quality outcomes and cost savings, we'll give you more of the payment. And that type of risk goes a long way, because to me it drives everything back to the administrator and the clinical team. If we provide great clinical medicine, which I know we do, and we can provide great outcomes, which I know we do, then we, you know, we can take on more risk. We can take on capitated arrangements. We can take on a more risk with a certain payer and a population, because we can manage it. And the administrator, you know, and I don't want to sound like I'm selling the book, you know, and everything I say, but I wrote the book to give the student and the instructor the information to be able to identify these opportunities of risk, understand what they are, and be able to navigate through them and make it be something that's a good outcome for not only the facility, but for the patient, because there's awareness level, financial and clinical, that needs to take place, and these risk arrangements will make that happen. If you can successfully navigate them, I told Sophie, we were talking at length, there's a story about U.S. Healthcare when it first came out, and you talk about risk. They said, we're going to give you an HMO, no co-pays, no nothing. You pay your premium, you go where you want, have a great day. Well, they implemented it, they started doing it, and with the utilization goes through the roof. So they had to look at, well, how do I get this to work right? We got to share the risk a little bit. Put a $2 co-pay out there, they reduced utilization by 14%. We take that same approach. Now, 14% seems small, but for U.S. Healthcare and the amount of members, it was huge. So we take the same approach. If we can look at risk, and that was a different type of, you know, outcome. If we can look at risk, if we give great care, great outcomes, why can't we have the facility benefit with more of the funds from, you know, from the insurance company? So that's where we take the student. That's how we make it work for them.
Great. Thank you, Kevin. Well, I think we're just about ready to wrap it up. I have one last question here. In an earlier slide, you mentioned consent forms. I have seen the advanced beneficiary notice before when I took my parents to the doctors. I am not sure what it is and why it's important.
Well, I'll give you an example from my folks. My mother-in-law, you know, God rest her soul, she went into the lab. She went into the doctor's office and said, oh, you need to get a blood draw, you know, for whatever reason it was. But in the Medicare regs, you can't get it done but every 90 days. Well, this was day 87. So, you know, you can go in, the lab knows it's not going to be paid, and they give the reason why, and they get the patient to sign off on it. You may come across where the facilities are getting the patients to sign them on just as a blanket statement, so if they don't get paid properly, they can go after the patient. And that's not the way that the form's designed. The form's designed just to take care of patients, to let them know that their responsibility is up front, and they may have to pay for this test because of, well, you had the test done only 87 days ago. Medicare only pays for it every 90. So that helps keep the facility in compliance and not having the patient sign off on just everything. Because I found that, you know, patients will write checks if they're told that they owe money. They don't want to owe anybody money, and they write checks, and really they shouldn't have in certain instances. So the ABN is designed to protect the patient, let them understand when they're responsible for payment, and, you know, in what circumstances that would take place.
Great. Well, that's pretty much it for questions. I see one more question about accessing the case studies, for those who have more questions, I'm going to reach out to you directly to help get you access to those case studies. And I think unless I missed some questions, if I missed your question, we will certainly, you know, you can email me directly and we will be sure to get your question answered. But I think at this point, given the time, I'm going to go ahead and wrap things up. I did want to just briefly mention, just going to change the slide here, that Kevin's book is available now. It just published earlier in the year. It is available now. The Complete Navigate to Advantage package is available as well. If you go to this URL, go.jblearning.com/Harrington, you can request a complimentary review copy if you'd like to consider this for course use. There's also sample chapters you can download, and you can request access to ancillary materials, including the instructor's manual, test bank, and PowerPoint slides. And again, the book does include complimentary Navigate to Advantage access. That is the access code card that's included with the book. It includes a complete ebook. There's a study center with practice activities and flashcards, a homework and testing assessment center, and dashboards with learner and educator views. I encourage you to go to jblnavigate.com/2. We've got a lot of videos there that show you how Navigate works, whether you want to just allow your students to use it for individual study, or if you want a full, if you'd like to do a faculty-led course, we can get you a course ID and get you up and running with that. Let's see. I'm going to advance the slide. Let me also thank you for participating. If you've got further questions, don't hesitate to reach out directly to me. Kevin has also kindly offered to answer any of your questions. You can contact him directly at his email address is here. And I want to thank you again for participating. Kevin, thank you very much for your presentation today.
You're welcome. With that,
I'm going to go ahead and ask Marianne to close the audio. I'm going to leave this slide up on screen in case you want to make a note, and we will go ahead and end. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you
for participating in today's conference. You may now disconnect. Presenters, please hold.